It is with immense joy and anticipation that we gather for a transformative exploration into the heart of well-being. Today marks the beginning of a journey towards achieving equilibrium in our lives, both personally and professionally. As we dive into the essence of balance, self-care, and harmonious living, let's embrace the opportunity to unlock profound insights and strategies that will shape our paths to fulfillment. Our distinguished presenters are here to guide us through the labyrinth of achieving a balanced existence, from mastering work-life harmony to navigating the intricacies of empathy and boundaries. Each session promises to be a beacon of enlightenment, and the wisdom shared today is not just theoretical. It's practical, relatable, and crafted to empower you in your quest for balance. Welcome to the NCU Media Group Back to Basics Workshop. To our friends in the Zoom classroom, I hope that you made it. Well, those who registered, I hope you made it. And if you came early, then you were in on the games and the giveaways. If you were late, then you missed out on that. I want to welcome our viewers on NCU TV Jamaica and on EJC, Watch EJC Live. Also on NCU FM 91.1, 91.3, 91.5. You see, today we are looking forward to an exciting program. Today, we want to thank our sponsors, the Ministry of Labor and Social Security's PATH program, Advancing Your Family, Developing Jamaica, and CariMed Group Limited, Swiss Mambo Sauce, the Everything Sauce, and also Carla's Escape Day Spa. When inside, forget the outside. Certificates of participation will be given to those who registered and attended on Zoom. So stay in class. We're watching you. Without further ado, let's dive into a balanced existence, taking care of you. Your journey to holistic well-being begins right here, right now.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is with great pleasure that we introduce our first presenter for today's Back to Basics quarterly workshop, Nadine Burrows-Siaga. A formidable mindset, performance, and leadership coach, Nadine brings over a decade of expertise in coaching senior managers, executives, and CEOs to achieve outstanding results in both their personal and professional lives. Nadine's illustrious career includes making a significant impact in insurance sales at Life of Jamaica Limited. Known as a force to be reckoned with, she possesses a unique ability to develop powerful teams and cultivate enviable workplace cultures wherever she goes. Her purpose, rooted in creating dynamic and uplifting workplaces, has led her to become a professional certified coach by the International Coaching Federation. Passionate about helping people level up their lives, Nadine's impact extends across industries and companies, both locally and internationally. She is a proud member of the Private Sector Organization of Jamaica and the International Coaching Federation. Today, Nadine will guide us through the crucial topic of mastering work-life harmony and boundaries. In this insightful session, she will cover the art of balancing personal and professional goals, effective time management strategies to prevent burnout, allocating time for self-care and personal priorities, defining emotional and physical boundaries, communicating and maintaining boundaries for overall well-being, and recognizing when to set boundaries to protect one's self. Ladies and gentlemen, let us welcome Nadine Burrows-Siaga with enthusiasm as she shares her wealth of knowledge and empowers us to cultivate a balanced and a fulfilling life.
Thank you very, very much for that very kind introduction. I would love to just welcome everybody myself to this session. I could talk on this topic forever, but I won't today. So the first question I think that most people need to define for themselves is, what exactly is a balanced life? And I've asked this question for for years, and every response is slightly different. So the first thing everybody needs to really get clued into and become conscious of is what would be different about my life if it were balanced. So what is it that I'm not paying attention to? And I'll tell you why that's an important question to start with. It's because what you spend your time on, you know, it's what they call whatever you're spending your time on, it means you're not spending your time on some other things. I want to really just speak in a very simple way, because sometimes when we talk on this topic, it's over everybody's head, and I don't want to do that today. So I want you to ask yourself is what exactly would a balanced life, and why do you think that your life isn't balanced right now? So most people talk about a balanced life as your balance between your work and your personal life. And it's pretty much that's it, right? But there are several areas in both of those areas of your life that you might want to also dial in. Like, what about your personal life? Is it that you're not spending time with family or friends? Is it that you're not getting to spend time with yourself? Is it that you're not getting to spend time? So whatever it is, I want you to start to think about what that actually is. And here's the thing. A lot of times we think that there should be some equality to the time. And what I want to offer in this session today is there's something called intentional imbalance. And that definition worked remarkably well for me. And what that really means is that every single day is not going to mean that I'm going to be able to do a lot of my personal stuff. Or in some times of the day, I'm not going to be doing a lot of my work. But what will happen is that when I'm giving, and why that's important, let me just be clear, is that many times people are very focused on trying to create that balance. And in trying to create that balance, you're actually throwing yourself off balance. In trying to find that equal time for both areas of your life, you actually throw yourself off. So it means that when you are deciding that from 7 o'clock onwards, I'm going to be focused on my kids and my family and my partner, I'm actually there in present, in physical, but I'm not there mentally. And so how much of a balance is that really for you? It's a question that you must answer for yourself. And so what I have found that has been very helpful is that I have decided that that sort of a balanced life does not work for me. And what I will do, however, is that whatever time I'm going to be present with my husband or my children or my friends, I'm going to be all in. And that does not necessarily look like 7 to 10. Sometimes at 10 o'clock, I'm in my office, which is right here where I am right now, working. But what that also means is that at 3 o'clock, if I'm spending time with my children, and obviously my children are adults now, but certainly when they were younger, I would be spending time with them at 3 o'clock, at 4 o'clock, because I work for myself. I had that luxury, and maybe a lot of your callers don't. So we're going to get into what they can do. But it meant that when I'm there, I was all in with them in that moment. So it's not that I'm going to be trying to work out that I'm up for 16 hours, sleeping 8, and that half of that time it's work and the other half is personal. Sometimes I don't think that that's a practical approach. I think that actually creates more imbalance in trying to create that kind of a 50-50 breakdown, or even 70-50, whatever it is. So I find a more relaxed, a more flexible approach to balance is the definition I have found to be most useful for me. And certainly my clients have also liked that idea that, I can be doing work for 12 hours, but once I've completed that work, I'm now free to be there with whoever it is and whatever it is I'm doing. So that's first thing I want everybody to define for themselves. What does a work-life balance really ideally will feel good, will feel right for you? And it's going to be different for every person. Once you attain that, once you get that in your brain, like you have now worked out, okay, for example, I love my work. I could work all the time, I have to confess. So I know I have to rein myself in, and I'm lucky because my kids are big now. They're adults. They really don't need me as much as when they were much younger. So I have that luxury. For you, that might not be the case. So I want you to think about whatever you are in your life right now, this, what does balance look like? Know also that it's going to be different later on when your circumstances change. The other component I want to ask you is, how can you know, because I'm sure a lot of you might be thinking that this is just my life. How do you even know that you are maybe not balanced? So I'm going to give you a couple, maybe three, maybe five little tips to look for to determine whether it's something that you might want to be thinking about or looking at. And the first one is, maybe there's a constant feeling of tiredness or fatigue that you might be experiencing. You constantly feel exhausted. So this exhaustion, by the way, is not just physical exhaustion. It's mental and it's emotional exhaustion. So I want you to think, it might be that you're saying something like, I'm always so tired. It might be as clear as that. Or I can't tell the last time I felt rested. And I remember that one, and I wanted to say it because I have a very good friend who's telling me that right now. And I've said to her, hey, it looks like you're not getting the right balance for your life right now. So think about, is that one of the things that you see? So constant fatigue is one of them. Another clue is perhaps that you are noticing you're neglecting your personal relationships. You probably say something like, you're not spending enough time with your friends. And you notice that you're saying, I can't tell the last time, I keep missing out on my getting together with my friends, or I can't remember the last time I had dinner with my family. So think about whether that's something that you notice, that you consistently say to yourself about your personal relationships. Another area that could clue you in on whether it is that maybe work-life balance is the problem is maybe there's a decline in your physical health. So you probably are having frequent headaches. Maybe there is weight gain. Maybe there's a weakened immune system. You're catching everything that's passing you by, whether it is a flu or whatever it is. So think about that. Is that something that you're noticing that's different in your life at this time, that's different from what it was before? There's another one, maybe the fourth one could be, if you are always thinking or talking about work and you find that you can't even go off to sleep before you check your work email. If that's something that's happening to you or you find that you're doing to yourself, it might be some rebalancing that is required. And I would say maybe the fifth thing could be an increased irritability, a change in your mood where you're feeling a lot of anxiety, maybe even signs of depression. You're getting frustrated quickly. over small things. And so you might be saying to yourself or maybe to your friends, I feel like I'm always on edge, or everything just seems overwhelming to me. So those are, I would say, just some ideas, just some thoughts for you to give, to think about whether it is, I notice I'm saying these things. Some of you might be saying, I'm feeling all of that, right? Or I'm noticing I'm saying all of that. So if that is the case, what do you do? Well, listen, I don't have any magic pill, unfortunately. Nothing.
All right, we are having a little bit of a technical challenge there. We've lost connection with Nadine Borisiaga, and she was sharing some very important points. What we're going to do, we're going to take a short break, and when we come back, we will, well, we'll hopefully be able to reconnect with Mrs. Borisiaga. It is Back to Basics, the final one for the year 2023.
It's not too late.
It's not too late.
Not too late.
Not too late.
It's not too late to participate.
It's not too late to donate.
It's NCUFM's 13th anniversary Mediathon under the theme, Expanding Our Reach, Inspiring Hope.
We're in the month of December, and guess what? It's not too late to participate.
Invite your family and friends to join you as you pledge your support.
It's not too late to donate.
Send your pledges via WhatsApp to 876-457-1414. Or call 876-963-7711 or 876-963-7735.
Remember, it's not too late to participate. Your donation could do something great.
Welcome back. It's Back to Basics, and it's about a balanced existence taking care of you. We were listening to Nadine Borisiaga, and she shared some very important points, and I was here checking one, checking two, checking three as she went through, and we'll talk about that when we get to the end of the presentation. We're glad to have her back. Over to you again, Nadine.
So sorry about that. We had a little power outage, but I'm here. All right, so I was saying to you, I ended the five clues that you could start to become aware of that will determine really whether you are, in fact, your problem is lack of work-life balance, because it's important to identify what the problem is, right? So that you can go to the solution. And I mentioned before also that you have to define what work-life balance looks like for you. And it doesn't look the same for everybody. So think about what's important to you. Is it your work? Is it your family? Is it your leisure? Is it your self-care? What are the elements that would need to be in place for you to feel like you have a work-life balance? But before I go into some other, some actual ideas and some elements that you might want to consider working on, I wanted to say this, that where does this idea, by the way, come from that has us out of whack in the first instance? And what I mean by that is we have some, what I like to refer to as pass me down beliefs that tell us, especially women, in one way or another, that they are not enough and that a part of their value is in taking care of everybody at the expense of themselves. And I see it all the time with my clients where the first thing, the last thing before going to bed is checking that everybody is fine. Or when they wake up, it's about what they need to do, who they need to, you know, look after, everybody, husband, children, team members, friends, everybody. And the last person, if at all, is themselves. And so what we want to do is we really want to question how true is that even and how helpful is it? So that's just, something that I thought I really wanted to also add, because I'm not sure exactly how many of your listeners are women versus men, but I know that in particular for women, that's an ongoing challenge that they have. And so working on questioning and asking yourself, you know, how true is it really that that's my value? And how true is it that that's what I should be doing? Because I tend to believe that, boy, when I take care of me, heaven is present, is available for everybody else. When I'm not taken care of, I can't say that so much. So everybody, you know, think about that. But let's jump into a little bit of some, because I know that we've lost some time already, but let's jump into a little of some key elements, some key areas that you can work on to create more balanced lifestyle. The first thing is awareness, right? Becoming aware of exactly what areas you want to give more time to and what areas it's going to then cost you. What areas you're going to have to do some things different in to allow yourself the time, because we all have the same 24 hours. So it's not as though you can squeeze in any more time. You're going to have to decide what it is you're going to do with all of those seconds, of all of those hours, of all of those days, right? What it is you're going to focus and put in those times instead of what you're currently doing right now. So it becomes, so awareness is the first thing, understanding your own needs and your own limitations and recognizing when you're feeling that sign of, when you're feeling that burnout. The second thing is time management, managing your time much more effectively. As I mentioned, there is no more hours coming. So it's about what you're going to stop doing, what you're going to start doing, or what you're going to continue doing. So organizing the time between your work and your personal activities. So for example, yesterday at 4 o'clock, I ended my work and I went and played pickleball with my husband. It was amazing. And then when I came back after relaxing, I went and then did some work for an hour. That to me is great work-life balance. Just an example, right? So you have to decide what your work is like and the times that you can take and do what you want to do with it in terms of what is most important for you. So you're going to have to, in time management, you're going to have to look at prioritizing your tasks. You're going to have to look at avoiding overcommitment. And you're also going to have to look at setting realistic goals. The other area that I would ask everybody to consider is boundaries, setting boundaries, establishing clear limits on your work time. And you want to ensure that you, you know, so there's a technique I use. I put in all my things in my calendar that I want to do that fills me up. I put that in first. That's the first thing, and it goes in red. If any of my clients are on here, they will know that this is true because I share my screen with them all the time. The things that are filling me up. So it could be playing pickleball. It could be having a massage. It could be reading a book for my own gratification. Those times, I put times for everything because if it's not in my calendar, I won't even do it. And I'm ashamed to say, but not really. That includes picking up my kids when they were younger too, right? That I would put everything in because then I could free my brain to think about whatever. So I put everything in and then I set clear boundaries around those times. And what that means is that boundaries are things that you set around yourself. Some people confuse it. They think they set it around other people. No, you set it around yourself, but you have to be the first one to honor it. So if it is that you're saying you're going to work between this and this time, you have to be willing to actually say no when people want you to work outside of that time. Or, and I'm just using work now, but it doesn't have to be work, whatever else that comes up. So I want you to think about what it is that you really want, where you want to spend your personal time, and you put that in your calendar and do not break it, because all of a sudden the boundary becomes nothing more than an empty threat. Then I want you to be flexible. So when, even as you set your boundaries and you prioritize your task and all of those things, life happens. So I want you to think about where you might want to do some give and take in that without necessarily breaking your own boundaries. Where is it that you're going to give and take? Maybe it is that right now there's a lot of options available for people to do work from home, remote work, flexible working hours. See if that is something that you can broach with your manager or your business, whatever it is, that will give you some flexibility to allow you to have time to tap into the things that you really want. And I promise you this. I want an employee that is fulfilled. And I suspect that most people here, I'm going to just put it out there, that I think that your whoever it is that you work with, work for, is probably wanting the same thing. And the reason I think that is because, as the introduction spoke to, I work with a lot of leaders. And I know that one of the things they want is, yes, they want hard work, all of that, but they also want someone highly engaged. So it's going to be very difficult for you to feel like you could be all in into this work when it's draining all your time and taking up all your energy, right? So flexibility is going to be an important part. Then there is stress management. And I kind of touched on that a little bit when I spoke about really finding time to do the things that matter to you. And for me, for example, I exercise every day. No, not every day I get up, I want to exercise, but I know that when I exercise, I'm going to actually feel better after. So I have to put a delay this bad feeling right now, and I just go through it. And then I know that at the end of it, I'm going to feel better. And I don't exercise for very long. So it doesn't take up a lot of my time. I do maybe 15 to 30 minutes every day. But some of you explore your hobbies. I remember working with an executive team, and she couldn't even remember the last time she did something she enjoyed. And so I want you all to think about what it is that you actually enjoy doing. Take that hobby back up, and then practice some relaxation techniques, and just continue to do your very best. It's not a dash. It's a marathon. So you're going to do some pieces today, and then you just add to it. You don't have to do everything all at once. The thought of doing everything can be very overwhelming and actually bring on stress. So you want to look at how to ensure that you do all of these things to reduce the stress, not add to it. And listen, at the end of the day, regardless of where we are, our personal life matters. And you matter. So prioritize your personal life. So think about your own dreams, your own goals, whether you're working for someone or not. Maybe there's something else that you want to do. I want you to start to give your attention to these things that really matter to you, and think about it as a way of your own self-care so that you can show up more powerfully. And is there anything else that I'd like to add? I would think that hopefully that was quite a bit, and hopefully you're taking notes and you can start to think about the ways that you can give up certain things that you're probably doing now, and also how you can start to take that first step in towards this place that you really want to go. And the biggest piece is that, listen, some people have never done value work. When I say value work, meaning identifying what's valuable to you. And the reason that's going to be important as you embark on setting your boundaries and prioritizing your task and managing your time and choosing all of that is that you want to ensure that the steps that you're going to take are taking you towards the things that are really important to you and not away from them. So when it is, for example, freedom is one of mine. I'm going to give you an example. The thought of not feeling that freedom is scary to me. So every decision I make, if I'm taking on new clients, I look at my schedule and I see how much space do I have to do the things that I want in my calendar. And that might sound, maybe some of you might not think that you have the capacity right now. That's just me. That's where I'm at. There was a time when I didn't either, but I've worked that place. So it's all about taking the steps towards where you want to go, even if you're not quite there yet. What is the smallest, simplest baby step you can take towards that? And that's what I'd like to leave with everybody today. Don't think that if you can't do everything, that you shouldn't be doing anything. But even though some of these things are simple and easy, the problem with simple and easy to do is that it's also simple and easy to not do. So you just choose anything that you heard today as one thing that, you know what, from now on, I'm not going to spend 10, however long, I was going to say 10 minutes, but maybe it's longer than that, 1 hour scrolling through social media. I'm going to read a book, or I'm going to do something. But maybe if that's what works for you in that moment, that's fine. But oftentimes scrolling on social media is an escape. So I don't want you to confuse the two, right? It's about taking care of yourself and trying to also understand what are the messages, what would have been keeping you from actually doing this in the past? What is a belief you had that you thought was true that had you in this place of overworking, or, you know, whatever it is that has created this this imbalance in your life? Because until you address that piece, all of this is just going to be like a band-aid. The main piece is checking out, what is it that I believed? Like, I know that I had that work to do with myself, and a lot of my clients who have had to go through this eradicating of thoughts and replacing them with more powerful beliefs that have them living more powerful lives. So I'm open for any questions, if this is a point for that, or if not, that's it.
All right. We want to thank you so much, Mrs. Borosiaga. And later on, we will be having those questions coming your way. But for me, just listening to you talk about intentional imbalance, you know, is something that we're going to have to revisit. We heard the clues. And as we were listening to the clues, I know many people like myself were, you know, ticking off the points. Okay. Constant fatigue, neglecting relationships, decline in physical health, always thinking about work, increased in irritability and all those things. Also, yes. One powerful point you made was about the steps towards freedom. We're going to be revisiting that later on. But let me check in with Tajel with what's happening on that side. Tajel, tell us what's going on in your corner. I think I'm not sure if your microphone is activated. Let's see.
Yes.
Okay. You're good to go now.
Okay, so you're hearing me now.
Yes.
Uh-huh. Awesome. All right. So in Zoom, we had a lot of persons in on the pre-show, and they're still here locked in with us. I'm seeing a question here from Denise Alexander. She's saying, how would you approach text messages or emails about work on the weekends?
So that's for me, right?
Yes.
Okay. That's where your boundary comes into play. Now, boundaries is a beautiful thing, right? When it comes to work, have a conversation about your time off when you're not going to be answering. And you just let them know that you won't be checking your emails until Monday morning or whatever it is. You just inform the person about what it is that you're going to be doing. And that's what I would say.
Awesome. And another question, what's the first step for workaholics? What's a step that workaholics can take to balance work and other areas in their life?
Well, they would need to ask themselves some questions. Like, why do I feel like I need to do all of this? Why am I working constantly? You know, it's very difficult for you to make a significant change in your life until you understand the root of it. So they want to find out, why is it? Why is I working? What do I think is going to happen if I don't? Like, that's a question they should consider asking themselves.
All right, there you go. And just some comments here. Robert Lewis is saying that he learned a lot and he's continuing to learn a lot. Tyndale Dover says this is a refreshing segment. Thank you so much for those valuable tips. So that's all the information we have right now. So Mr. Kelly, over to you until later on.
All right. Thank you so much, Tejel. Tejel Coley in radio studio and over there with our viewers on the participants Zoom. Well, we want to thank our sponsors, the Ministry of Labor and Social Security, PATH Program, Advancing Your Family, Developing Jamaica, and CARIMED Group, Swiss Mambo Sauce. Also, Carla's Escape. When you're on the inside, forget what's happening on the outside. Yeah, relax. And now, ladies and gentlemen, it's time for our next presenter.
Coming from the vibrant parish of Trelawney, our esteemed presenter, Dr. Paul Smith, is a true people person, grounded in the philosophy that if I can help somebody as I pass along, then my living shall not be in vain. Dr. Smith brings a compassionate and purpose-driven approach to his work. Married and a proud father of two, Dr. Smith embarked on his academic journey at Church Teachers College, further enriching his knowledge at Jamaica Theological Seminary, Caribbean Graduate School of Theology, and California Southern University. His educational repertoire includes a diploma in Spanish, a bachelor's degree in guidance and counseling, and dual master's degrees in theology and counseling psychology. Notably, he holds a doctorate in clinical psychology from California Southern University. As the founder and director of Love and Restoration Ministries, a registered charity and nonprofit organization, he actively contributes to community welfare. Beyond his academic and charitable endeavors, Dr. Smith wears multiple hats as a minister of religion, marriage officer, justice of the peace, and a motivational speaker. With over 15 years of clinical experience, Dr. Smith operates a private practice called New Life Counseling and Psychotherapy Services in Santa Cruz, St. Elizabeth, and in Mandeville, Manchester. As the regional coordinator for the Jamaican Psychological Society Southern Region, he actively contributes to the advancement of psychological well-being in the community. In every role he undertakes, Dr. Smith brings a wealth of knowledge, compassion, and a genuine dedication to improving the lives of those he encounters. In our workshop today, Dr. Paul Smith will delve into the crucial topic of maintaining empathy and support for vulnerable family members while setting clear boundaries to protect your own well-being and to prevent burnout. We're honored to have him as our distinguished presenter for this workshop. Ladies and gentlemen, help me welcome Dr. Smith.
Thank you so much. Let me say good evening to the listeners and the viewers. And it's an awesome privilege to be on this evening. I want us to look at self-care, but in particular, how we take care of our vulnerable family members, including babies, the elderly, and even those who are mentally challenged, those who have mental illnesses. It's a task that many persons undergo, and you know, they too, if we're not careful, will have mental health issues as well. So self-care becomes extremely important in this regard. So what is the self-care that we're looking at? It is a habit. It's a deliberate act of taking care of one's own mental, emotional, spiritual, and physical well-being and happiness, especially during stressful periods. So already we know that self-care takes in the mental faculty, it takes in emotional, it takes in the spiritual, and it takes in the physical. And so if self-care is not adhered to, it can affect us physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually, and if there's another alley, financially. So the World Health Organization defines self-care as the ability of individuals, families, and communities to promote health, prevent disease, maintain health, and cope with illness and disability with or without the support of healthcare worker. And so I am saying to us that self-care is our own responsibility. We have to make sure that it's not a ad hoc situation that we find ourselves in, but it's habitual, it's a lifestyle. And that to me is self-care. We move on. So we look at taking action, empathy, and boundary. So we might say to ourselves, I have a baby to take care of. I have children to take care of. I have my elderly dad, my grandma. I have a brother who has schizophrenia or other mental illnesses. And so it is important that empathy be shown. But there has got to be a balance between empathy and setting boundaries. And our previous presenter talked so well about boundaries. But what is empathy? It is the ability to emotionally understand what other people feel, see things from their point of view, and imagine yourself in their place. So it is actually putting yourself in somebody's shoe, as is commonly said. You know, you try to travel with them as to how they feel, the range of emotions that they go through. And we do this without judgment, right? We listen to them, which is a part of empathy. So whatever they are going through, it doesn't matter how often they speak about it, we listen actively. We listen to say that you can talk to me. I care about what you're saying. I am interested in what you're going through. So I am listening. That takes in, of course, eye contact, not staring, but eye contact, right? And as a part of empathy, we continue to show care and concern, right? So whatever the issues are, whatever the task to undergo, you know, we continue to show that care, right? We show that, hey, I am here for you. You are not alone, right? I am with you. I won't say I am with you always. But I am with you. I will hold your hand. You know, whatever you're going through, I am here. And we show that particular concern as well. But there's another point I want us to pick up on, and it's for us to be self-aware. And self-awareness is a part of what we call emotional intelligence. So the caregiver has to look within him or herself and say, am I exhausted? Am I in this thing for the long haul? What am I going through? What are my biases, right? How is it that I can give more? Or am I giving too much of my time? Do I have the necessary support system, right? Is it that I can deal with someone, a family member, who has cancer? You know, how do I deal with it? What are my limitations? What are my strengths? And what are my weaknesses? So all of these become part of empathy. We move on. So we maintain empathy, and we acknowledge the person's feelings and without judging. And there are times when persons are very quick to judge. So a family member is sick and in constant pain, and we say to the person, be quiet, you're crying too much, it's unnecessary, right? And we tend to judge. But it's important that, you know, somebody's expressing him or herself. Oh, you told me that already. I heard it already. Why are you saying it again? What is wrong with you? Right? And we start to judge them. We must do it without judgment. We must show emotional support. Try to feel as much as you can what they're feeling. Right? We might not understand totally, but we can just say, I appreciate the fact that, you know, you're not feeling well, you know. I can't understand, but I can appreciate it. So the support is good. And caregivers have to run errands. They have to make sure they take care of the elderly person. And so the burden can be there. And incidentally, I might put that, you know, just recently I did a research on caregiver burden, because this is one of the results as well that caregivers go through. the burden of caregiving, right? But you also need to communicate your understanding of what is happening, right? So we're looking at the vulnerable family members. We're looking at those who are mentally challenged, right? And sometimes you have to make sure that though their thoughts are not coherent, you still are there listening to them without judging them. So a family member who is mentally ill might say, look at that man over there. And you say, where is he? Tell me what you see, right? Instead of just casting some doubt and say, there's nobody there, right? We have to make sure that as caregivers, we should communicate and show understanding. We move on. So boundaries. Boundaries are very, very important. And boundaries must be set to guard ourselves against getting burnout, right? And we have something also called compassionate fatigue, right? And sometimes we get to do so much that after a while we become empty. And there's a common saying that you cannot pour from an empty cup, right? So self-care is about the caregiver. What do I do to safeguard my emotional health, my mental health, my physical health, right? There comes a time when the caregiver should be on stage and should be the star of the show, right? And so it is my time. So it is important that it is now my time. I have been giving and pouring into the lives of others. And if I do not get back, then I am going to be like a broken down truck, right? I am going to be ineffective in everything that I do. So there comes a time when you say, I need to replenish myself. I need to get back some energy, some focus, some vitality that becomes important in setting boundaries. So I am saying to you that boundaries are meant to protect one's well-being and prevent burnout. It is having the courage to love yourself even when you're disappointing others, right? So there are persons who might feel guilty that if I take a break and take care of myself, others are going to feel bad about it. Others are going to criticize me. Others are going to call me wicked and unfaithful, right? But it is actually looking out for yourself. It is the courage to say that I love myself, that I need to give myself that attention. So in return, I can continue to care for my vulnerable loved ones. It is about building a support network for yourself, right? So finding that boundary, it means that you seek a support system. It could be a group that you often might just log into, whether it is online or it's in your community. It could also be other family members who you call in to say, hey, I'm feeling really exhausted. You know, I think it's time that you take over now and treat mama and papa and grandma and grandpa and whoever it is, right? And when we set boundaries, we ought not to feel guilty, because guilt can be an enemy of self-care, right? So though we take a break and I want to go to a hotel for a weekend, I'm not enjoying the hotel at all because I am busy feeling guilty. But my God, what if the person dies? The person can't do without me. What am I doing, right? And so the guilt takes over that you're not enjoying your stay away at the hotel or wherever you are. So guilt should not be a part of it. And we also need to define and share our limits. So we all have limits, right? We can do so much and no more, right? And sometimes we overcompensate because we're trying to please others in saying that we're doing our best, but then our bodies have a tendency to speak, and we ought to listen to what our bodies are saying. If we are exhausted, then it means that we need to do something about the exhaustion. If we have compassionate fatigue, it means that we no longer feel empathy. We become cold, and we start to quarrel and say, you're in pain, so what? Right? Then we need to make sure that we set some boundaries and some limits. Accept help from others is important. So there might be others in the community who might know of what is happening and will offer some help. So for example, somebody might say, all right, you can go to the supermarket or you can go to that function and I'll spend an hour or two and I will stay with the loved one until they return. There are persons who are still kind enough to offer that kind of psychosocial support, and the caregiver should not allow pride to get the better of them, but accept help when help is offered. Delegation is important, right? As I said before, right? So we can't do it all. We can't move the mountain, right? There are times we have to say, hey, I think that you should do the laundry today. I think you should go to the pharmacy today, right? I think you should prepare dinner today. Delegation is important. But there are persons who believe that, hey, I must be a champion, I must be a hero, so I should do it all. And that is the recipe for burnout. Encourage independence, right? So the loved ones, we should teach them to be independent, that even if you're not around for a while, they can still survive. They can do some things on their own instead of being totally dependent on us. So if we leave them for an hour, then their world collapses. We have to teach them to be independent as well. Set a schedule is important. Bedtime, when it's bedtime for me, right? When it's exercise time for me. When it's time for me to sit and watch some cartoon or a nice movie, right? That becomes important, right? When is it time for me to cook, prepare the meal? When is it time for me to wash? There must be a schedule. And there must be a plan of absence. So if I'm leaving home, then I must have a plan. Who will stay? Who will take care of the loved one? Who will run the errands? So there must be a plan if I take some time off. And take up a hobby and have some fun. There should be no guilt in having fun, in sitting down and laugh, right? In going to the beach. And if you can't swim, you still run when the wave is coming at you, right? You must have some fun because that is a part of self-care and it's a part of setting boundaries. So as we move along, there are some questions I'd like to ask, and the answers to the question will determine whether or not you are open to self-care, right? How often do you worry about what other people think? Do you feel guilty for wanting to do things by yourself? When last did you say no to someone? When last did you say yes to something you secretly did not want to do? Do you feel like you deserve respect or you have to earn it by being nice? Right? All of these questions, we have to bring some self-awareness in it. Because if we think that we always have to be pleasing people, then we won't want to employ self-care when it comes, or we'll do it with guilt. So the final part is some self-care tips. How can the caregiver then take care of him or herself? And I say that self-care is not selfish, right? It's not selfish. It is actually replenishing so you can continue to give, can continue to serve, right? So one, get enough sleep. Sleep is important, right? And do your best to keep a consistent sleep schedule, right? So if we are up all night and all day, we're going to lose focus. We're going to get agitated. We're going to get easily upset. We're going to become angered. So we need to sleep. That is important. And setting a sleep schedule is very important. Eat a balanced diet and include fruits and vegetables, because fruits and vegetables, a balanced diet, will allow us to feel good and appeal to the motivational hormones or a chemical reaction, right, becomes important. Water is preferable than juice or drink. Yeah? So we drink water to replenish ourselves. Managing stress becomes important because giving care can be very stressful, especially if the resources are lacking. We don't have the finance to buy the medication if they're not available at the public pharmacy and we have to go privately. That can become a thing. If our mentally challenged relatives need to go and honor their appointments and we have to charter a vehicle, right? That financial issues as well, right? If we have to work around the clock, that is an issue as well. So we need to learn to look at issues, look at the triggers. What gets me so upset and so exhausted, right? What are some of the things that the loved one might say to me that, hey, you're ungrateful. Leave me alone, I don't want anything from you. And we take it personal, right? We need to take breaks, mental health breaks. Go for a walk. Yeah. Change the environment and go somewhere and just breathe and be and live in the moment and say, yes, I love me. Get a chance to love yourself and to appreciate yourself, right? That becomes important. Thinking positively is also important. Might be hard, but it's possible. Poor me. Why me? Why me, Lord? Huh? Other persons are free and up and about, and I am stuck at home. And we entertain the negative thoughts, and that feed into our psyche, and we also become depressed and stressed. Read, watch your favorite shows or movies, and try not to feel guilty about not being productive. So there are persons who believe that if I sit and relax, and I watch Tom and Jerry, and I watch something else, oh Lord, I think I'm wasting time. I feel lazy. No, relaxation is extremely important. Listen to some soothing music that will speak to the soul, deep in the soul, and just relax and enjoy it becomes important. Use scented candles or diffuse essential oils, and this is absolutely awesome, right? And you're just savoring the moment. You're enjoying the moment. Keep up with your doctor's appointment. It's very important, right? Because you need to know what is happening in the body as well. And if you're stressed out, stress can lead to so many other things. And also the dental checkup is also important. And I talk about mindfulness. And mindfulness is taking the time to just live in the present, live in the moment, enjoy the moment, look around you. What are you seeing? Listen. Do you hear the birds chirping? The horns honking? What are you listening to? What are you seeing? What are you feeling? What are you smelling? What are you tasting? Becomes very, very important in mindfulness. Exercise is good. Do some simple stretches to get your blood moving. Go for a walk. Dance. Even if you can't dance, still try to dance. I can't dance very well, but I do dance, and I think I love what I do. Nobody judges me. They cheer me on whether or not it is true, but I feel good about it. Have lunch with a friend. Yeah, just go somewhere and sit and have lunch. Go to the beach, as I said before. Go for a hike. But importantly, connect with others. Don't stay in silo. Connect with a friend or relative. Talk. Talk about how you're feeling. If you're feeling stressed, talk about it. Let it out, right? It is important that we connect with others. And finally, treat yourself. Get a manicure, a pedicure, a massage. And I call it handshal and footshal and facial. Same thing. But treat yourself to that. Buy yourself something nice. Affirm yourself. I am awesome. I am caring. I am compassionate. I am doing my best. You have to affirm yourself. Smile. Laugh at yourself. Play. Pray and fellowship and connect with God is important. So some reminders. Remember, you cannot pour from an empty cup. Self-care replenishes you so that you can continue to show care to the people you love. Love for others and love for ourselves are not alternatives. With every act of self-care, your authentic self gets stronger and the critical, fearful mind gets weaker. Every act of self-care is a powerful declaration. I am on my side. Each day, I am more and more on my side. So self-care, ladies and gentlemen, is extremely important. Thank you.
All right. We want to thank you so much, Dr. Paul Smith. And boy, I tell you, I already feel the load coming off just by thinking about the things that I need to do. So sometimes you not even start acting as yet, but knowing that there is a way to fix the problem.
Absolutely.
It starts letting the burden off. And I love the part that says, you know, well, self-care, it depends on you, but it also requires support. So, yes. My self-care requires the support of those around me, family, friends, understanding that, look, if I decide that I'm taking some time for myself today, we normally hang together and do things, and I'm doing something for me, then it's not because I'm selfish. It's simply because I need to just take a break from everything else. And also the matter of guilt feelings.
Yes.
Yes, that's something that we are going to have to come back to in the question and answer segment, because we do have a lot of individuals who feel guilty. You know, okay, so mom is sick at home, and yes, you're there for her all the time, but this day, you need to go and get your hand shell, foot shell, and feet shell.
Yes.
You know, and you feel bad because while you're there, you're saying, boy, she's missing me, and so on. But then it affects the whole effectiveness of that self-care moment.
Absolutely.
So that's another thing that we're going to have to talk about in the question and answer segment. We want to do something special at this time, and we want to thank you, Dr. Smith. Well done. There's a special category of individuals who often find it particularly challenging to prioritize self-care. And as I mentioned a while ago, some may express feelings of guilt, perceiving self-care as a selfish act that takes away from their families and those who depend on them. We're talking about people who are categorized by their self-sacrificial nature, moms, mothers.
Yes.
Yes. We want to find out how this supermom takes time for self-care. So we have joining us Mrs. Melissa Cunningham Cuff. Hello, Mrs. Cuff.
Hello, good evening.
Yes, it's great to have you with us. Let's talk a little bit about self-care for moms and the whole idea of how you take care of yourself. As a parent, how do you find time for self-care?
And, so being a parent is a very challenging, but it's also a very rewarding full-time job. And of course, I've discovered that it is very important for me to take time out for myself, because I've learned that, as cliche as it might sound, it is, you can't pour from an empty cup. So it's necessary for me to take the time to relax and re-energize. No, self-care will not look the same for everyone. For most people, it might be a weekend trip or time at the spa or the facial foot shell, but it can also be very simple things. It can be simple things that you can easily add into your everyday routine, like taking time to watch a movie or reading a book or taking a nap or going for a walk, or maybe calling a trusted friend to just, you know, whether it is to vent or to get advice, or it can be journaling or listening to music. So what I try to do in my everyday, because, you know, between parenting and trying to work, I have very little free time. So I try to find bouts of time in between to make sure that I'm taking time to tend to my own needs. That, for me, is what self-care looks like.
Let's talk to other parents who might not, you know, because we all get overwhelmed as parents, one way or the other. But just about the importance as a parent to set boundaries and practice self-care, even on your caregiving journey.
Okay. So I've discovered that if I'm tired or if I'm frustrated, then I can't show up for my child in the way that a rested or a happy me can show up for him. And once I've realized that self-care is part and parcel of taking care of my child. When you look at it that way, it helps to take away the guilt of feeling, okay, I'm over here and I really need to be tending to my child. Once you realize that when you tend to yourself, it's really for not just the benefit of you, but for the benefit of the child as well, then you realize how important it is. My child is a six-year-old, so for me, setting boundaries is going to be a little bit difficult than for an older child. For me, it's more like establishing a routine. So making sure that there is an established bedtime, meal times, having him clean up after himself at times, setting age-appropriate chores. Very importantly, making sure that I don't reward bad behavior. So a tantrum should never end in the child getting what he was having the tantrum for. And also important for me is allowing independence. So if your child is old enough, for instance, to dress himself or to brush his teeth, allow him to do those things. Encourage independence, because it means less work for you as the mom, and you want to make sure that your child can, you know, grow up and go out into the world and survive without you. That is really the goal of parenting, to prepare him, to watch him learn and discover the world and to go out and take that on his own.
Parent who has to deal with, who is working with a child who requires special attention and has to carry out her daily routine too. Well, his or her, because parents, we're talking about men and women, you know, fathers and mothers.
Okay, so if it is that a child has a challenge, for me, and this is not feasible for everyone, but for me, what I have done is to cut back on certain areas of work that are more, I find to be more time consuming. If that is not feasible for everybody, then I think what we need to learn to do is to know when to ask for help. Whether we're going to ask for help from the other parent, whether we're going to ask for help from family members, ask for help from a trusted friend. We need to learn to, you know, to take those small breaks when we can, so that we don't be too hard on ourselves and that we have time to replenish. One of the things that I also do, because if it is not possible for you to take that time away, one of the things that I also try to do is to learn to have fun together. So part of self-care can be while the child is there with you. So my son loves music and he loves to dance. So one of the things I will do is to turn on the TV, go on YouTube, and we will have a dance party. I get a workout, he gets tired and goes to sleep, and then mommy gets some me time after he's in bed. For children with challenges as well, I would suggest reaching out to other moms who may have children with challenges for support and advice. Chances are excellent that if you are having a challenge, there is some other mom who may have been through a similar experience and can offer some insight as to how you can deal with it. The internet is also a wonderful resource. The more informed you are, I believe the less overwhelmed you will feel. So use the internet as a resource to just check to see persons in similar situations, persons with children with similar challenges, what they have done, what have worked for them, and it will give you tips as to what you can try that just may work for you as well.
And any other strategies? I know you mentioned some before, strategies and tips that you've found effective in achieving, you know, work-life balance as a busy parent that you would want to share with others?
Other strategies, okay. So have times where you ask for help, leave the child with somebody who is trusted, take a day for yourself, decide on what makes you feel fulfilled, relaxed, and energized, and do that. Incorporate rest and relaxation into your everyday. So don't wait for the time when you can take a full day or a full weekend. If you can take an hour here or there, if it means taking a nap, if it means locking yourself into a room and reading a book for an hour, don't be afraid to do that. It always helps to have other persons who you can call for advice. It helps to plan events that you know your child will enjoy and you will enjoy, so you can enjoy those things together. So just really think of things that you can do on your everyday, small everyday things that you can do to just keep yourself focused. In terms of work, for me, I prioritize work during school hours. If it is a younger child, then I would understand that being a difficulty, you may need to seek help, whether from, like I said, the other parents or a family member. One of the things that works for me also in terms of balancing work and my child is that I work from home. So it gives me the flexibility so that it might mean that when he goes down at night, I have some time to do some work at that point in time. So my schedule isn't as rigid as somebody who has to do 9 to 5. But just small things to take care of yourself, very important. And finding the time when the child is otherwise preoccupied to focus on work.
Thank you so much, Melissa Cunningham-Cuff, for sharing with us. And I know that many parents have found that information you shared quite useful. And we're going to be looking at some of the questions that we have coming in, and we want to engage our presenters in fielding some of these questions. I see where someone is asking about a key area in which you can work on to get a more balanced lifestyle. Oh, yes, that's a question coming from a listener asking for a key area you can work on to get a more balanced lifestyle. Okay, who's gonna take it? Let's see. All right, okay, let's start with our first presenter, Mrs. Boris Siaga. All right, doctor.
Yes.
Oh, okay, there she is.
On mute. I didn't realize I was on mute. So the question was, what is a key area that the person can work on
to yes.
more balanced lifestyle? Well, that is such a, I'm sorry, that it's not a very, can the person be a little more specific, or is it the person is asking for some ideas? Because it kind of depends on where they are in their life. Like, what is it that they think is missing? So is it a personal, is it a, you know, time for children? Is it time for partner? Is it time for, you know, what is it that they are trying to, it depends on what it is that they are trying to achieve. What time is it that they wish they had to spend with doing what, with who? I'm not sure that I'm clear about what the question is.
Determining, you know, what is the most important based on their situation, because if it is that it's a matter of trying to, as there's one, in fact, that a person is saying, I work 9 hours, commute for 4 hours, and have 2 small children and a spouse. I constantly feel overwhelmed. How do I find time to improve my life, and how do I improve my time management with so little time?
That's a great question. Listen, you know, I understand that challenge, and yes. I want the person to think about what could they change. So they're spending 4 hours commuting. Is it that they can work some days from home? I mean, I think COVID has opened up the eyes of everybody that what we thought was impossible is actually possible. So is what is it that they're going to have to change? Because 9 hours at work, 4 hours commuting, it sounds to me like maybe commuting is an area that they could really inspect a little bit more. What could they change to reduce or eliminate that time? Is the person, can a person interact with me?
I doubt it. It was sent in via text.
Right. So that's something. In other words, they have to look for those areas that they can change and plan to change it. Because until they change something, it's going to be almost impossible for something to change. In other words, the big picture to have the outcome they want.
Wonderful. You know, here's one that might be a little, some people might find a little touchy, Dr. Smith. The question is, how do you get someone who is wearing you down with negativity to understand that you care, but you're not managing their toxicity and it's affecting your well-being?
It's a touchy one. Yes. So it's a matter of, as I said before, it's a matter of making that choice that I am going to do things for me and not to feel guilty, right? Because if I speak to that person who is toxic and, you know, I say, all right, I am going to create some boundaries, right? I am going to say no, or I might say to the person that, you know, the energy that you give me, it's really not the good thing, so these are the things I'm going to do. You have to be resolute and to be strong and to be firm that, you know, for my whole well-being, for my health, these are the things that I'm going to do, and we do not entertain the guilt.
I'm wondering, it's such a heavy question, I think I would want to bring in reinforcement also. So I don't know if you want to drop something on that, Mrs. Borisiaga.
You know, listen, there is a thought that I have, and I have gotten to that place through trial and error. So I'm about to say something, and it might sound offensive, but it is really quite a beautiful. I found it to be very useful. I like how the doctor said it. You have to be willing to A, prioritize yourself, because until you are full, it's very difficult for you to pour into others. And I kind of put it a little different when I was talking. I had written it down, and then when the light went, I couldn't see it. But when I'm taking care of, heaven awaits you. And so the thought that comes to mind is this: I have to be okay with your upset. You don't need to be fine. You don't need to be approving of what I am saying, I'm doing, or whatever it is. You don't. So this is what I'm doing. It's actually setting a boundary where you're saying to them, this is what I will not tolerate. And I have a plan to not tolerate it. Because remember, when you set a boundary, you know, you set it around yourself. So the other person's behavior doesn't have to change. When your behavior changes, you are teaching them how to be with you. So after a while, they will now know that it don't make sense talking to her or to him, because, or I'm not going to bring this negativity to this person, because they're clearly, you know, it might be that you're going to leave, or you're going to, whatever it is. So you have to be clear about what it is you're doing. And you have to get to a place where you're going to be, you're just going to have to be okay with them feeling whatever it is they feel. Your job is really not to control their feeling. That's manipulation. What you're here to do is control your own. So one of the ways you control your own is to be okay. All right. I'm not so happy that I feel that way, but listen, this is better than the alternative.
Yes. I'm okay with you being upset, but this has to happen for me to be okay. If that's what it takes, then.
Absolutely.
Yes. Yes. How do you deal, Dr. Smith, with caregiver fatigue in the case of you're honoring the till death do us part, but there's no one else to help, and it becomes heavy on the individual? And many people are afraid to even say that, to admit that, you know, it's a heavy task. But how does one deal with that, especially when you have no other support?
All right. And that's a real situation. So there are times we speak from the standpoint that everybody has a support system that everybody has, right? But in that regard, it is important that we find, we can even find a support group, a support system. Mm-hmm. There is something called saving the boat syndrome, because there might be other persons.
Boat, yes.
Yeah, going through mm-hmm. the same thing. How, and we ask the question, how do you handle it? How do you cope? What are some strategies that you use, right? We go back to the issue, too, of if it's a case where we can teach the person some level of independence, right? So that we can also take that particular break. It's important. But we find that if you become overwhelmed, it's also important to speak to a mental health professional. Because mm-hmm. there are times that the things that we do are beyond our coping mechanism, beyond our capacity. We don't have the resources, so we reach out to others who can listen to us, because sometimes the feelings are pent up inside and we can't get a chance to say anything to anyone. So we seek professional help as well and look at strategies, right? And as I said before, there might be persons, even in the community, who are willing to offer help. And if they offer us help, we need to take it.
Awesome. Never be too proud to accept help.
Ah, offer the help. You know. Even for an hour. Mm-hmm. Somebody say, I can help you out for an hour. I can run some errands.
Mm-hmm.
I can help to spread the bed. Something. Mm-hmm. Just accept the help.
All right. Thank you so much. And Taj, what's the temperature where you are?
All right, so I am seeing where persons are being really interactive in the chat. I'm seeing Una Morris agreeing with the discussion. I am seeing, first of all, since we have started the broadcast, I have seen Robert Lures with his camera on. It seems as if he's taking notes. I'm not really sure, but he's paying a lot of attention to what's happening. I'm seeing Denise Alexander say thank you for the tips. She's noting all of them. Shorian Williams-Grant is also commending the presenters. Nicolon also agreeing. I see persons saying, I struggle with asking for help, but I accept if it's available. Somebody else is saying, I struggle with delegation, then suffer from burnout. So I realize that a lot of persons are coming to a realization of certain bad habits that they may be having, and they're taking the advice from or professionals. So I think that's very important. Mm-hmm. And it's pretty much the point of the Back to Basics workshop. So they're having a grand time over here and they're being very much informed.
Wonderful. It seems like you have a little confessional going on over there too. Guilty as charged, you know. All right, we want to say thanks to our sponsors, the Ministry of Labor and Social Security's PATH program, Advancing Your Family, Developing Jamaica, CariMed Group Limited, Swiss Mambo Sauce, the Everything Sauce, and of course, to Carlos Escape. When you're on the inside, forget about the outside. Yes, just relax, enjoy, and be pampered. And, you know, there is a special feature that I want to bring to you right now. Yes, as we continue our journey through a balanced existence, taking care of you, we're about to delve into a special segment that adds a touch of authenticity to our understanding of self-care. Our host, Akiwa Green, she stepped out into the community to discover inspiring stories of people practicing self-care in unique and unexpected ways. Let's go to Akiwa.
Welcome to this segment of the Back to Basics workshop under the theme, A Balanced Existence, Taking Care of You. We will be exploring unique ways persons practice self-care. I am your host, Akiwa Green, and we will be going out into the community to talk to a few persons and see how they practice self-care uniquely. Come on, let's go.
Hi, I'm Chantel Neal. Yes, I am a mom of two. I'm a student. I'm a wife. I do a whole lot of things.
My mother named me Joel, and then I got the name Mikkel, and my father named me Hay. So it's Joel Mikkel Hay, and I am originally from the southern parts of St. James, where persons like Arnold Kelly and I grew up together. Yes, so we have been classmates coming right through. I have made my exit from this institution of higher learning 30 years ago. Was privileged to be employed as a full-time pastor before graduation.
Hi, I'm Dr. Morton Anthony Frankson, otherwise known as Dr. Tony. And I am a medical doctor, so you're actually interviewing me in the medical health services office where I see patients. But most of my days are spent, and most of the time of any day is spent with research, because that's really my primary job here. I'm the director for research for Northern Caribbean University and for statistics, as well as this medical ministry mission here and any other medical ministry mission that we want to be involved in.
A typical day for me, I wake up at 3 in the mornings to get things started. At 3 is when I begin to get myself together for the day. At 6, the family wake up, and so it's time for me to get breakfast ready, get the boys up, get them ready for school, and we try our best to leave out at about 7:30 for us to get to school, because we all go to school in the same area, so we move together. So it's a little bit, but by the grace of God, we get to do it every day. When I get here, I get straight to begin to prepare my running order for today's shows. I would make calls. I'd sort out what plans we have for the show time, ensure the guests are on time for their interviews, and the day just runs on. So my work day typically ends at 5. I leave the office at 5, and when I get home is where my other part of the work starts. When I get home, it's to prepare supper. And so we have some family time, and then at 9, the boys go to sleep, and at 10 is where I end the day.
My role is multiple. Yes, and I served as the senior pastor for the university, and with particular or specific responsibility for the church. However, I served as one of the administrators, so I serve on the administrative council of this university. I give directives as it relates to the building and the church building complex. I serve as counselor. I do a number of premarital sessions here and online. Likewise, I do weddings here and right where you need it to be done, and do a lot of empowerment seminars. I'm also one of the adjunct lecturers in the School of Religion and Theology, where I teach all final year ministerial students. My specialization is in pastoral care and counseling. Self-care means a lot, because if I don't take care of me, I cannot take care of thee. So I have to ensure that I am taken care of. Having my regular exercise, and most times I get involved in meaningful exercise. It is you as an individual who decides your behavioral pattern, your norms, the way that you are going to function, which is a process. So my behavioral process, or the process of my behavioral activities, they are intentional, very intentional. So when I get up in the morning, personally, I would have a glass of water, room temperature, to make sure that I enjoy the vitamin B12. Then, especially in this climate when it is flu season, I have a glass of warm water with lemon juice. Help to build up the immune system. I also use a taste of my nature's antibiotic, which is made up of a dash of honey, lemon juice, turmeric, you can put a little black pepper seed, not black pepper, black pepper seed, because it helps you to absorb both vitamin C and iron.
Well, one of the things it means is prevention, because that's the best way to care for yourself is to prevent getting problems in the first place. And then my peace of mind with God as well is the most important part of that.
It is still true that reading makes a full man and writing a complete man. My wife and I, we are involved in a lot of reading, especially now that we are home alone. And we discover a lot of things and we go the natural way. I'm a health reformer as long as I can ever think about it. My diet is based mainly on vegetarian products, so it's over 38 years I have not eaten flesh food. And I am very close to 60. Mm-hmm.
I take 2 to 3 tablespoons of olive oil every morning.
And yeah. What does that
mean? Virgin, extra virgin. It's full of antioxidants. It's a green color in the olive oil, especially the ones that have more green color. They're right. Full of the antioxidants. And those help to, the free radicals, they just help to make your inflammation in your body, etc., counter and just keep you at good immune readiness. Since I've been here, for example, it's been really healthy eating. And I also add to that sometimes some natural products that I could get from the pharmacy, like a little bit of zinc or vitamin D or my multivitamins for men who are over 50. I know you don't believe I'm over 50, but I am. And, you know, other things like my CoQ10 or once in a while aspirin. I don't take aspirin every day, but I take it once in a while. I used to take it every day, but the recommendation has changed, so I changed with it. But I didn't change to cut it out completely. I changed to use it once a few days a week. And so that's that.
Well, over the years, being a mom is not easy. Having a family is not easy. It takes a lot of your time. And considering that I'm a student, that too takes a lot of your time. So if you'd sit and evaluate yourself, you wouldn't have time to do anything for yourself. And so I've found these things because these are the things that I enjoy, I am passionate about. And so I like to do things that would help me to be a better person, be a better mom, be a better wife. I like to cook, so I'd watch videos that's related to cooking, you know, learning things. And so these routines or these self-care things has helped me a lot along the ways. I've started side gigs with these kind of routines. Not these kind of routines, but these kinds of self-care videos. So,
as a doctor, I have studied nutrition a bit, and I've added more than even what they taught me,
right.
Because they could big room in there to add more. So I did. Right. I did that. As a doctor, you're required to go to so many seminars every year to get continuing medical units, and I do all of that. Plus, taking care of people makes you remember the things that you see the most.
As a mom, some people might think that it's kind of selfish to close out yourself from the world to some extent, but it's necessary for your mental stability. You need to take a break, you know, and not taking a break, you will be of no use for your family. And so you have to see it necessary to take a break, a step aside, so that you can rejuvenate. You know, I tell my kids sometimes when they come knocking at the door, I tell them I need a minute, give me a minute, and they understand what a minute means. You know, and say they would, whatever they have to ask me, they would ask their dad. I'd say, go to your dad, check with your dad. You know, so it's intentional for me to take that moment for myself.
Truth is, knowledge is not static, it is dynamic. In the multitude of counsel, there is wisdom. Individuals who have the skill sets in areas that will enhance your self-care, it's important for you to make contacts with them. Make sure you have a family doctor. And if your self-care requires or it works best for you in going the natural way, allow the doctor to guide you accordingly. You will also discover that the platforms are many, social media. So you become very much aware of what works best for you and do it the natural way, because it is healthier and it is more lasting.
I like to dress up. I like to look nice. And so that's a part of self-care, you know. With the hustle and the bustle of motherhood, it's easy to lose your physical appearance. And so you will want to find yourself in that place where you're not taking care of yourself physically. As hard as it may seem, I still find time to put on my makeup in the morning, put on my face, I would say. And that's one of the things that helped me to look presentable and, you know, an extra flair for the morning. So I don't leave without putting on my makeup. I don't leave without ensuring that I look my best at all times. And so that's just me. That's one of the things I do. For a woman out there that might be listening, you find what makes you feel good. If it's sitting down, eating a nice breakfast, getting your smoothie in the morning, whatever it may be, you do you.
Well, it is God's gift to us. Our body is made by Him. So I go back to Him and I ask Him to guide me. And I would encourage anybody to do that. Okay. I also would encourage you to do some of your own learning, teaching, investing in the books and self-help things. But don't neglect coming to the experts like myself, the doctors and so, and giving you a sound bill of health. Checking you out to make sure you're safe and fine to do whatever you need to do. And keep in touch with us. And if we ask you to do certain things, comply with us. So those are some of the things that you can do. And you need to ask God to give you the Holy Spirit to keep you, because the Holy Spirit will comfort you and encourage you and coach you and remind you to exercise and remind you to be faithful to whatever you need to do. It's a teamwork thing. God has put us all together to care for each other. So just cooperate with each other and you will go far in life.
As we are about to wrap up this segment of the Back to Basics workshop, we hope that the stories of self-care that you heard encouraged you to also practice self-care. It may not be easy, it will also be unique, but just start. Do something to help you and your well-being. I'm Akiwa Green. Thank you for joining me on this journey, and I'm sending you back to studio.
Thank you so much, Akiwa. And boy, I tell you, powerful experiences there. And I like the fact that they not only talked about ways in which they took care of themselves. You know, they take care of themselves daily. And as such, you know, these are things we can learn from and apply to our own personal lives. The matter of exercise, the matter of eating right. And, you know, as we heard from Chantal, you know, she gets up in the morning and she still finds the time, as busy as she is, to put on her face, you know. So, you know, you take time out to pamper yourself a bit. And talk about pampering yourself. We have three giveaways and we want to ensure that everybody gets a chance, you know, everybody gets a shot at it. So the first one we're going to give away on on YouTube, on the NCU TV Jamaica platform. So if you're watching on that platform, this question is for you. Name one way in which you can know if you have a work work-life balance, or if you're having a, if you're not having a work-life balance, if you're having an issue with work-life balance, tell us one way that was mentioned on the program that you can know. One of the signs, one of the clues. All right? So let's see. We will see who takes that one. We have a gift for this person. Compliments of Caramed Group Limited, Swiss Mambo Sauce. Yes. And as we move on, let's see. Do we have a winner? We have a winner. Oh, boy. I think that's Maxine right there. Right. Okay. Congratulations. We have a winner. And on the EJC platform, yes, watch EJC Live. Now, you're going to list two self-care techniques listed in today's program, mentioned in today's program. Two self-care techniques. That's for someone on the EJC platform. Right. So we have gifts for you, and our prizes come from Caramed Group Limited and Carla's Escape. All right. Do we have a winner on the EJC platform? Let's see. All right. And while we're at that, we have a question for someone on Zoom. So if you're in the Zoom room, and I know, you know, you're excited and waiting for your certificate, right? One step closer to it. Dr. Smith and Mrs. Cuff both mentioned something. They said something. I'll start the expression, and I want you to complete it. You can't pour. Complete the expression. That's for our friends on Zoom. And while we wait to hear who our winners are for these two, we want to say thanks to our presenters, Nadine Borosiaga, and of course, Dr. Paul Smith, who joined us in studio, and Melissa Cunningham Cuff, who also joined us remotely. And trust me, we were fed today, right? And we are at a place right now, I'm pretty sure, that where we are better able to handle this matter of the work-life balance. Yes, as we seek to become a better version of ourselves. Want to thank the technical team led by Mr. Gosford Lawrence and the crew. Thanks to our producer, Shanessa. Yes, Shanessa Hall. We want to also thank Fabia Phillips Lawrence. She is the chief cook and bottle washer, right? And the rest of the team. All right, so do we have the names? All right, the names are coming in. Okay, so let me just jump over here so I can see who our winners are, so we can personally thank you as we get ready to go. Yes, the EJC question again is, let's see, it says, name two or list two of the self-care techniques mentioned in today's program. Techniques shared on today's program. Two of those. Oh boy, looks like Ruth Ann Brown is the one taking this one. Hey, Ruth Ann, good afternoon to you and congratulations. And we have on Zoom, we have Dolores. Dolores, it seems like Dolores is our winner on that side. Again, thank you so much for being a part of this experience. You can't pour from an empty cup. Remember that. And remember also that when it comes towards the steps towards freedom, not because you can't make giant leaps. Make those baby steps. Start somewhere. Do something. Just go forward. And don't be afraid to ask for help when you need it. Yes? And find peace of mind in communicating with God. I'm Arnold Kelly. Thank you so much for joining us for this Back to Basics experience. It's the last one for the year, a balanced existence, taking care of you. So my advice to you is simply take care of you.